Hello everyone, and my today's review is devoted to the GIO G3, which is the middle-end phone from the famous Chinese manufacturer GIO. Like the previously tested G1, this phone is also based on the MediaTek system on chip, but as you can see, this phone is much bigger and this phone is much more advanced, of course, and it's much more expensive, but still it costs only about $200. So first let's take a look at the box of this phone. As you can see, there are two boxes. Both have the sign GIO. The first box contain only the special case. It's a bumper, it may be different colors. This one is brown, as you can see. It fits phone quite well and it protects phone quite well, but nothing else I can say about it. Also, this box contains the protective, the screen protector. But I already installed it on the phone, so nothing else here. And now let's take a look at the box itself. So as you can see, it's GIO G3 1 GB of random access memory. So this phone has 1 GB of random access memory. And the box is again more advanced than the box of the G1, and it's also plastic box. It's very hard, so the chance to damage them, to broke the phone inside this box is very low. And now let's take a look inside of this box. So what we see here is a package of the phone. It's an instruction manual, again in Chinese, but as you can see, it's more advanced, it's colored than the manual of the G1. It's a warranty card also in Chinese. The phone has a good cradle, which also protects the phone perfectly, as you can see. Also, what we have here is headphones, but you may receive the phone without headphones. It's just like a gift from the seller. Also, there is a data cable, the adapter, and the charger, of course. This charger is 500 mAh, standard charger with the USB out. And what I should say, you may use the other charger, because this phone is capable to take at least 700 mAh, so 500 mAh may be a bit not enough. So it may charge faster than with this standard charger. And now let's take a look at the phone. So what we have here is the big 4.5 inches HD screen with the resolution 1280x720 pixels. Also, there is a frontal camera. It's a 2 megapixels camera. It's a speaker. It's a LED light indicator, which may indicate red and green light when the phone is charging, or when the phone is discharged, it lights red. And when you receive the messages or the phone calls, it's green, and also when the phone is fully charged, it's also green. Also, there are a couple of sensors. It's a proximity sensor and light sensor here. The screen is covered by the Gorilla Glass of the first generation, and it's a real Gorilla Glass. But I also installed the screen protector, which comes with this phone. Also, you see the three standard touch buttons on the front panel. It's a menu, home, and back touch buttons. These two panels are made from metal, and the chassis, the body of this phone is also made of metal, but the case is actually made of plastic. Also, what we have here is the microphone, the micro USB, nothing here, the power button, and the standard 3.5 millimeters headphones plug, the volume rocker down and up, and on the back panel we have the 8 megapixels camera with autofocus and single flash, and the main speaker. And as you can see, there is a sign, GIO G3, 1 GB RAM, 8 megapixels, Android smartphone, which is absolutely true. Now let's take a look inside of this phone. So what we have here is a big battery. It's 2750 milliampere battery, and what I should say, it's a real capacity. So this battery is thick, it's about 6 millimeters thick, and it's rather big, as you can see. So the capacity is real, and the battery life is also very good. I'll tell you about it a bit later. What else we can see here is a memory slot for the standard microSD cards, and two mini SIM slots. One is compatible with 3G SIM cards, and the second slot may be only used with the GSM cards, actually. So that's it. Also, you can see the antennas, the GPS and Wi-Fi antennas. The building quality is quite good. The only drawback here maybe is the back panel, which is made of plastic, and it looks not so very nice actually, but it's quite good also. No problems with the build quality actually. So it's absolutely monolith, no squeezes, nothing like that. And now let's turn the phone on. Of course, as always, I installed the custom firmware to this phone. This one is based on the official Android 4.1.2. But it's of course much more advanced. It's rooted. I installed the advanced recovery and so on, as always. But actually, the phone has the official Android 4.1.2, so you may use it if you like, and you may choose one of hundreds maybe custom ROMs for this phone, because it's extremely popular, so there are many ROMs. So let's check the interface. As you can see, it's absolutely fast and fluent. And it's because this phone has rather powerful internals. It's based on the MTK6577 system on chip made by MediaTek, and it's dual core Cortex-A9 1.0 GHz system on chip. The GPU here is the PowerVR SGX 531 Ultra with the enhanced frequencies. So it's rather powerful, but because this phone has a very advanced screen, it's 4.5 inches HD screen with the resolution 720 by 1280 pixels, so the performance may be not always perfect, but again, I should say, as you can see, it's quite fluent, despite the high resolution of the screen. Now, let's check the brightness of the screen. And what I should say about the screen, it is absolutely great. It's just fantastic, the screen is very good, and even the professional tests show the screen is very good. The pixel density is the same as iPhone 5 has, it's absolutely the same, about 326 pixels per inch. The colors are very good, they're just great, and the color space is identical to the sRGB color space. So actually I have absolutely no claims to this screen. The screen is, I should say, it's perfect. The brightness levels are also very good, so you may set the low brightness, which is absolutely good for the complete darkness. This is it. And the maximum brightness, according to the hardware tests, is equal to about 350 candelas per square meter. So it's good enough to use this phone under the direct light of sun. So that's it. Also, there is an automatic brightness, but I'll tell you about it a bit later. Now let's check the touch screen of this phone. The touch screen is absolutely great in this phone. It's a 7-point touch screen, as you can see, and it works perfectly, I should say. Let's test it by DevTools. It is very sensitive and it's very good, I should say, absolutely no problems with this touch screen. And the hardware test confirms that. Now let's check the sensors. This phone has a lot of sensors. First, it's of course the accelerometer. Here it is. It works, of course. Also, it has a working gyroscope. It has a light sensor, and it also works quite well, as you can see. Also, it has a magnetic field sensor or the digital compass, which is the same. Also, it has an orientation sensor, and it also works. It has a proximity sensor, of course. Sound level is the microphone, and it has a voltage sensor and the temperature sensor, which also works quite well. So this phone has most of the sensors available in other phones, including the expensive brand phones. And all of them work without any problems, also, which I should see. Of course it has a vibro speaker, as always it's normal. Now let's check the settings of this phone. The settings are quite standard for the Android 4, 4.0, 4.1 and 4.2. They are rather similar. So the phones are different from the tablets because they have the additional item, it's the SIM management, which is now inactive because no SIMs installed into the phone right now. Also, there are Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, of course both modules are integrated here. The Wi-Fi sensitivity is very good, I'll show it to you a bit later. The Bluetooth works also without any problem. Also there is a profiles for the sound, which is also different from the tablets. The display settings are quite standard. The storage, this phone has 1 GB of random access memory and 4 GB of flash memory integrated. Also, you may install the microSD memory card. The battery. The battery is 2750 mAh in its real capacity. So it's very good. The applications. The location settings. This phone of course has the integrated GPS module and you may use also the Wi-Fi networks, and because it's based on the MediaTek chip, it can use the EPO assistance, which is the downloading of special file with the positioning of satellites, and this function should speed up the positioning using the GPS, and of course it supports the standard A-GPS feature. Here is a list of languages. The list is not full. As you can see, there are about 20 languages, but most of main languages are here. As you can see, it's Android 4.1.2. The version of the phone is JYG3N. G3N maybe because this phone, this specific phone, has renewed the new version of the wireless chip. It's unlike the first version of G3, which had the MT6620, this one has MT6628. So the sensitivity of Wi-Fi, Bluetooth and GPS is improved in this version of the phone. And it's really so. I had the ability to compare the old and new version of this phone, and this one works better with the wireless interfaces. Now let's check the Wi-Fi. So as you can see, the phone sees a lot of networks, and my network has a level of signal about -40, -38 dBm. The maximum level of signal for my network near the router is about -23, -25 dBm, which is a really good result. So this phone has no problems with the Wi-Fi. Bluetooth also works well. I don't use it very frequently, but I tested it in this phone and it works quite well. The GPS also works quite well. I can't test it right now because it doesn't work inside the buildings, of course. But I should say it works better than in the first version of the G3, and it works better than in the most other Chinese phones. So actually you won't experience any problems with the GPS positioning using this phone, I think. Now let's check the connection speed. I have a 15 megabits channel, internet channel. So let's test what this phone is capable for. And as you can see, it utilizes my internet channel completely. So absolutely no problems, about 15 megabits per second, and the ping is also quite low, 24 milliseconds. Now let's check the root. This phone is of course not rooted out of the box, but I use the custom rooted firmware. So now the phone is rooted, so you won't have any problem with rooting this phone. Now let's talk about the sound quality, because it's a phone, so you should use it to make calls, and actually I experienced no problems with this. The sound quality is quite good. The microphone and the speaker work quite well. The main speaker is rather loud, it's not perfect of course, but it's quite good, no problems with it. And now let's check the amount of free random access memory. So as I already said, this phone has 1 gigabyte of random access memory, and at the moment, as you can see, I killed all the applications in this phone. The amount of free random access memory at the moment is equal to 629 megabytes, which is quite good for the phone with 1 gigabyte of random access memory. So you won't experience any problems with the amount of free random access memory, unlike the situation with the previously tested GIG1. With this phone you won't have any problems. Now let's check the everyday applications, and let's start with the Opera Mobile with the internet. So, as I already said, this phone has a dual core Cortex-A9 1.0 GHz CPU, so the performance is quite good. In web applications you won't experience any serious problems actually. As you can see, the performance is quite good. In this version of Opera you can also use YouTube. The quality is not perfect, as you can see, but it works. And later we will test the YouTube application, in which there are no problems with the quality, of course. Now let's check the Play Store. This phone has no problems with Play Store and with the compatibility with the programs, even out of the box it's compatible with most of the applications. And of course, when you use the custom firmware, the amount of supported compatible applications is even higher. So absolutely no problems here, you may install any program you see here. As you can see, the download speed is quite good. So the Play Store works quite well. Now let's check the YouTube. This phone has a real HD screen, so actually it makes sense to use the HD videos in this phone. So as you can see, HD is supported and now this video runs in HD. Again, this video runs in HD. So, this phone is powerful enough to watch the HD videos in YouTube. And it's capable to run the HD videos in simple video viewer. So that's it. It works quite well, as you can see. Now let's check the Google Maps. This is the same regime. Well, most of the factories situated which produce the Chinese phones and tablets. And as you can see, this phone has no problems with the Google Maps. They work quite fast and fluent. Now let's talk about the camera. Of course, I cannot show you the work of the camera because it makes no sense, but I can show you the photographs on this camera. And the camera is quite well, what I should say. It's not perfect, but it's a normal, quite good 8 megapixels camera. And here is the photos of this camera. As you can see, the detail level is rather good. Not perfect, but quite good. So the main camera is a real 8 megapixels camera with autofocus and flash, and the frontal camera is 2 megapixels. It is also quite good for the Skype. It's quite enough. Now let's check the internet radio. As you can see, also no problems, works quite well. And now it's time to check the performance. Let's traditionally start with the Antutu benchmark. And here is the result. As you can see, 5,335 points. And it's without the SD card write and read speed, so we lose a couple of hundreds of points here, because this test refused to test the performance of the SD card in this phone. I don't know why, I think it's a problem of the test itself. And the final result is quite normal, it's average, it's not perfect. As you can see, the three-dimensional graphics is 950 points, it's not such a high result. The two-dimensional graphics result is 346 points. And the results of random access memory CPU and databases are quite normal for such system of chip used in this phone. It's a dual core 1.0 GHz Cortex-A9 system on chip. So here is the result. It's about the result of top smartphones of the year 2011, but the screen in this smartphone in GIO G3 is better and the resolution of the screen is higher, so the performance may be a bit lower because of the higher screen resolution. Now let's run the Quadrant. And here is the result. As you can see, it's 2858 points. The result is quite good, almost 3000 points. So for 1.0 GHz Cortex-A9 dual core, it's quite a good result. As you can see, it's a bit higher than the Samsung Galaxy Nexus, Samsung Galaxy Tab 10.1 and Motorola Atrix 4G. And it's lower than, for instance, the Samsung Transformer Prime TF201, which is quad-core. So with the quad-core devices, including the MTK6589, which I'll test very soon, we will get the higher results, of course, but this result is still quite good. Now let's run the VLLAMA. And you can see the results actually. It's 1267 points for the HTML5 and 349 points for the Metal. And these results are quite good. It's about the level of quad-core all-winner A31 and maybe even a bit higher. So actually the results are quite optimistic. This test shows the performance in the internet and in the World Wide Web. So you can see the results here. And they are quite good. Now it's time to run the three-dimensional test. Let's start with the NanoMark. And you can see the result. It's about 17.4 points. The performance in this test is not perfect, and it's because of the rather obsolete GPU. It's rather powerful, but still it's a bit obsolete. Power VR SJX 531 Ultra. So the performance is not so bad, but in some tests, including the NanoMark, the performance is lower than you may expect. So 17.4 frames per second. Now let's run the Basemark. And the Basemark doesn't like the PowerVR GPUs. And because this GPU is far not the most powerful among the PowerVR GPUs. The results are not perfect. As you can see, the performance is low. But this phone is capable to run this test. So it works. So only about 5 frames per second, and it's the lowest result among those devices I tested. But again, in the real games the situation will be quite different, and I'll show it to you a bit later. Now let's run the GPU mark. And the total result is 5000 points, and this result is not so much high, I should say. It's rather low result. I'm not sure what is the problem. Maybe it's the GPU drivers, because the US MTK 6589 scores almost 40000 points in this test. Of course, it has a much more advanced and fast GPU. It's PowerVR 544 single core GPU, but the difference should be so high, so maybe it's a problem with the GPU drivers, I think. Now let's take a look at the result of the GL benchmarks. So GL benchmark 2.5.1, and here is the result. The fill rate is about 200 megatexels per second in the on-screen mode, and almost 260 megatexels per second in the off-screen mode. This result is not so perfect, of course. It's about 1.5 times higher than the results of the Mali 400 MP1 in the Allwinner A10, and it's about 1.3 times lower than the results of the Mali 400 MP2. And of course, these results are much lower than the results of the Mali 400 MP4, PowerVR 544, and PowerVR 544 MP2. And you can see the frame rate in all the tests. So it's 3.2 frames per second in the Egypt HD. This phone is capable to run this scene without the problems, but the frame rate is low, of course. And even the Egypt Classic gives us only 14 frames per second, which is also not so perfect. But again, in the real games the situation is much better, as you'll see a bit later. Now let's run the GL benchmark 2.7, and here are the results. The fill rate is about the same as in the GL benchmark 2.5.1, and this phone is even capable to run the most difficult, the most complex three-dimensional tasks on the Android. It's the latest T-Rex HD scene of the GL benchmark 2.7, but the result is extremely low. In this run it was able to render only 36 frames, and the result is even lower than 1 frame per second, so there is no FPS results. The difference in the results is very high. As you can see, the results of Egypt HD in this test is much lower than in the GL benchmark 2.5. The scene is the same, so It's just the difference in different runs. And the results of T-Rex seem differences even higher here. It shows from 13 to about 50 frames in this scene, so the difference is very high, and this is the average result, about 36 frames. But what I should say is that this scene is so complex, it's so heavy, that even the most advanced and the fastest GPUs today are not able to run it fluently. And the last test of performance for today is the Epic Citadel. We won't run the 3D Mark because this phone is not capable to run it. I don't know why. Again, maybe it's problems with the GPU drivers. But the Epic Citadel runs quite well. And let's see what it shows. And as you can see, one of the most advanced modern 3D benchmarks, it's the Epic Citadel, runs quite fluently. The frame rate is from 20 to 30 frames per second in most of the scenes here. And as you can see in the high quality test, the result is 22.6 frames per second, which is not so bad, I should say. And in the high performance mode, the result is higher than 26 frames per second. So the result is quite good, and the games based on the Unreal Engine, which is used in the Epic Citadel, will run quite fluently on this phone, which is rather surprising. It doesn't have the most advanced GPU, but as you can see, this beautiful and advanced graphic test is more or less fluent here. And now it's time to test some games.
Thank you.
can see this game is perfectly fluent. This game is also quite playable and fluent. The Angry Birds, of course. The Angry Bird is also quite fluent. Now let's run the more advanced games and let's start with the Bubble Rising. So as you can see, it's an average quality set. You may choose several lower levels of graphics and the performance will be higher, of course. But let's try and run it with the average quality. So the performance is maybe not perfect, but it's quite playable and rather fluent, as you can see. As you can see, it is actually quite playable even with the average level of graphics. With the lower level of graphics, it will be even faster. So unlike the synthetical tests, the real game runs rather fluently and it's playable. Now let's try the other games. And again, the death rally runs quite fluently, and again, it's quite playable, as you can see. Manugano is also absolutely playable. As you can see, the graphics level is set to medium. Let's try how it works. The latest Dark Avenger is a bit slow with the medium level of graphics, but still playable, as you can see. And you can lower the graphics level and then it will be even more playable. That's it. It runs quite okay, as you can see. The difference is not so high, but now it works substantially faster, as you can see. So that's it, and this game is also playable. It's the latest game, it appeared only several days ago in the market, I think. Next, let's run our traditional Eternity Warriors. So as you can see, the Eternity Warriors 2 runs not so fluently, but again it's quite playable. In this game, it's a bit trolley. You can also change the resolution level, and it influences the speed of the game. And you can see the average resolution in this game is quite playable. This game is also rather new. Again, this game is quite playable, as you can see, and you can even lower the graphics level and then it will be even faster. But even with the average level of graphics, it's absolutely playable. So the dead trigger is quite playable with the default graphics level, low graphics settings. And the last game for today is the Temple Run 2. And again, this game allows to change the graphics level. The visual quality is average, is now set to average. So let's try to play this game. You can see it's quite fluent, absolutely no problems. So that's the situations with the game. You can see that all games are playable, not all of them are very fast, but most of them are absolutely playable, at least with the low or medium graphics settings. So now it's time to talk about the advantages and disadvantages of this phone. I should say it has almost no disadvantages. Maybe the only disadvantage is the average performance of this phone, the performance of this system on chip. It's a dual core Cortex A9 1.0 GHz. I cannot say it's slow, you can see it by yourself. The phone is quite fast, it works quite fluently. So that's it. And the advantages of this phone are numerous. So there are many advantages. First is a good package, very good box, it's very hard and protects the phone well. It contains all the necessary stuff which you may need in the process of phone application and using. Also, this phone has a nice design, as for me. Maybe the only drawback is this line above the screen, which is not used by any sensors, any buttons and anything else. But maybe it's needed because of the high capacity of the battery. The screen is absolutely great. Absolutely no problems, it's maybe perfect. No dead pixels, no flares, very nice colors, very nice brightness, and it may be changed in the wide ranges. Very good contrast, so absolutely perfect screen. This phone also has a good amount of memory. It's 1 GB of random access memory, it's DDR3, and it's 4 GB of flash memory. And you may also add the microSD cards up to 64 GB and more. Also, this phone supports two SIM cards at the same time, so you may use it with the two different operators with two different numbers, and both numbers will be available at the same time. But of course you cannot talk at the same time with two numbers. This phone also has a good sound quality, a good connection. It has good Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, GPS works quite well. It has a lot of sensors, and surprisingly it's rather fast. The interface runs fluently, all the programs runs without any problems, and even the games are quite playable, even the three-dimensional games are playable, as you can see. Maybe this system on chip used in this phone is a bit obsolete, it's MTK6577, but you should also consider the price of this phone, it's only about $200, and for such price the phone is just great, I should say. I like it very much. I use this for several weeks as my main phone, so I should say it's very good. And now let me introduce my several next reviews. I've got several phones. It's previously presented a new i2000s, and recently I also received the 5-inch Hero H750 Plus, and it's also called Caesar, and it's also called Zoppo ZP810. It's all the same phones, so I'm going to make its review. And also I already received the several interesting tablets. It's Hyundai T7S with 2 GB of random access memory and Exynos Quad on board. It's quad-core Rockchip 3188-based Cube U30 GT2 with the Full HD Plus screen. I also received it already and tested now, and tomorrow I'm going to receive the Chewy V88 2 GB version. It's another copy of iPad mini. And also I'm waiting for GIO GeForce. Bimol already sent it to me, so I'm going to receive it in about 1 or 2 weeks. And all these phones and tablets will be reviewed by me. And our today's hero was GIO G3. It's a very nice phone. I hope you like it too. So that's it for today, and thank you for attention. Goodbye.